For more information, visit futurebased.org.
Welcome again to the Future Based X Inverse Surveillance AI podcast series. My name is Abdurrahman Hassan. I am the host of this series. I am a data science practitioner and educator, particularly interested in the intersection between technology and critical theory. Inverse Surveillance AI is a project of the Asimov Institute, which acts as a think tank of scientists, policymakers, and philosophers gathered to answer the question, how can we use AI as a panopticon to promote beneficial actions for citizens by organizations? Based on the insights produced from this think tank, a first proof of concept will be developed in a hackathon. The project lasts 6 months and operates as a utopian, solution-based approach. The main goal is to deepen the subject of inverse surveillance and to explore how AI can make this possible. In this podcast series, together with the Asimov Institute director, Stefan Leinen, we go into conversations with experts in the field of AI technology. Welcome again, Stefan. Glad to have you here as always.
Thank you, Abdo.
So in the last two episodes, we talked about the philosophy of surveillance. We interrogated the wisdom of the crowd, but we also looked at multiple ways to contextualize, expose, and relate to surveillance or the multiple surveillances there are. Today, we unpack a close relative of surveillance. Privacy. We seek to ask questions about how we can be more proactive in safeguarding our privacy, in holding surveillers accountable, and in building a system where everyone has the right to know. To do this, we have invited Nadia Benesa, a policy advisor at Bits of Freedom, which is a movement that stands up for internet freedoms in the Netherlands. Nadia is a human rights advocate. She has previously worked as a data protection officer at the municipality. She's also a humanitarian sitting on the board of the Kifaya Foundation, as well as a writer. Really, really happy to have you here, Nadia.
Thank you so much for having me.
Just to kick off the conversation, I want to ask you about Bits of Freedom. It's an organization that functions as a watchdog for protecting human rights and citizens against digital threats of privacy and loss of freedom. How do you envision the role of inverse surveillance as a method to counteract these threats?
Yeah, so at Bits of Freedom, we believe living in an open and free society is a basic human right. People need the liberty to move freely, express themselves, make mistakes, and have a personal life without someone looking over their shoulder, whether that someone is the government, using cameras, big data, algorithms, or other tools, or private companies that misuse personal data to make a profit. We don't think surveillance should have a place in our society. That is something we try to accomplish by influencing government policy and legislation. And I think the more people become aware of surveillance, the better they understand the risks and threats for their basic human rights. Surveillance is often invisible and intransparent. We're able to see cameras in public spaces, but we don't know how these cameras are being used. Are they able to zoom in or out, move into another direction? Are they able to recognize faces? So I guess inverse surveillance could help making surveillance more visible and understandable, although we don't really see it as a counteract, as it doesn't undo the surveillance. It does help in holding those who are in power accountable.
I think this is a great answer, especially the part about not undoing surveillance. And I think there should be a more systematic change. And I think my next question is really about changing our mindset. So is there really a way to incentivize organizations and citizens, which are responsible for surveillance, to adopt a model of reward rather than punishment?
I think the only responsible surveillance practices I can think of are those that comply with the law, including human rights law. However, we know that governments don't always work by the book. Research shows that municipalities and other governments have been spying on citizens on social media while using fake accounts. And these practices are against the law and the violation on human rights. We don't really think that a reward model would help to solve that problem. The government needs to know that the laws don't only apply on citizens, but to them as well. And they need to be held accountable for their actions. And we also see that law needs to catch up with technology. We need legislation that is more stringent on private companies, as well as more rigorous enforcement by supervisory authorities.
Thanks a lot, Nadia. And in a previous episode, we talked about having an equivalence system. So this is a system where the state surveillance, inverse surveillance, and citizen surveillance, which is known as sousveillance, are coexisting harmoniously. And in such a state of equivalence, there are many data flows between citizens, organizations, and governments. So from a law perspective, how do we ensure privacy in an equivalent system?
I wonder what society we would live in with one surveying the other. I can't imagine privacy would be still possible in a situation like that. Would the equivalence be that the rights to privacy of a person who is watching would be equally violated by the person who's being watched? I don't think two wrongs make it right. On top of that, the information provision of governments aren't comparable to those of private parties. For individuals, the information asymmetry is even larger. So it seems like a difficult thing to accomplish. Maybe the bigger question would be if society and individuals would actually benefit from different types of surveillance competing against each other.
And I think this is really a good point to piggyback off. Maybe we can pinpoint together certain aspects of society where inverse surveillance and sousveillance can be of benefit.
Yeah, I think raising awareness on surveillance practices would help to make people understand how surveillance impacts lives, and minorities and marginalized groups are often more subject to government surveillance. So, for example, police officers have an app they can use to register every police control, and this registration should help provide insight into ethnic profiling by the police. However, not many police officers are willing to use the app. So if these tools are offered to institutions with a position of power on a voluntary basis, chances are that they won't be motivated to use it. It should either be obligated or used by those who are marginalized. If these kinds of inverse surveillance work, people could denounce the disproportionality and injustice that comes with the use of surveillance.
Absolutely. And maybe I have a question for Stefan, because we were talking kind of embedding the justice or the fair usage or targeting the disproportionate populations in our design. So from a system perspective, we have kind of an anti-discrimination design when it comes to sousveillance. How do you feel we can use AI to help us?
Well, one thing that stood out for me, that is that surveillance can be, let's say, a force of good or a beneficial actor in society when it's in accordance with the law. Now, the law is not a complete set of rules with regards to having a ideal or, let's say, ethical society. So I think within the bounds of the law, we still have many ethical or moral or social rules that we wish to enforce, which are all within the bounds of the law, but more closely aligned with our ideals. And I think in this case, although we have laws against bias, against racial injustice, I think our ideals are actually much stronger than current laws. Well, one way to think about this is how could we build a surveillance system that is based on these ideals? And I think preventing racial bias is definitely one that hits close to home when it comes to AI, because filtering out bias is something we can actually do quite well with AI systems, given that we know what bias to look for. So if we are able to define bias, and for instance, our first article of our constitution gives a open-ended list of what bias can be. It's based on race, religion, gender, etc. But it says etc. And that's a problem for AI. An interesting endeavor, reaching beyond the extent of the law, going into our ideals and our ethics, we can ask ourselves, what would this etc. be? What biases are there that we would like to filter out beyond what is given to us by the law? So when we filter through data, like the data that Nadia just mentioned, could actually automatically find all these biases and get a more sort of complete picture of what inequalities exist.
Yeah, this is really a crucial conversation to have. And I've kind of learned over the years that even conversations about bias and how the definition of bias should be ever evolving with the uses and the onset of new technologies, that we should also have definitions of harm on top of bias. It affects different people differently. There is false associations, for example, that could happen between a group of people. And I think what makes this equation so hard to decipher is that a lot of the practices of surveillance are hidden behind black boxed algorithms. And this is precisely what I want to ask Nadia about next. What can we do as citizens in response to this algorithmic surveillance? And I know you mentioned the law as the go-to, but what can we do as people, as actors?
Yeah, so when we mention black boxes with social media, I guess one of the first things I think of is there was a lot of criticism after the 2016 US elections in which Facebook data was being used to manipulate undecided voters in swing states to vote on Trump. And a lot of data was being used to psychologically analyze voters in order to target them with the information and misinformation they would be sensitive to. So to make these analyses, they needed to know people better than they know themselves. You know, what scares them, what makes them laugh, what draws their attention, what they search for on Google, what spelling mistakes they make. This is a bizarre surveillance that has been going on online for years. First, seduce people into buying something, but later on to manipulate voters in democratic elections. So very few people saw the dangers of micro-targeting certain types of shoes. But it was easy to see the effects of political micro-targeting on society and democracy. So I guess it's really important for people to understand better how this online manipulation works. We at Bits of Freedom have developed an online course, which is called Korte Cursus Manipulatie, which takes you step by step how this online manipulation works and gives you tools on how to understand it better and protect yourself and your rights when spending time online.
So a strategy of countering this like hidden surveillance is exposing it, right? Is raising awareness on to how these algorithms work behind the scenes. And maybe you can give us a little bit of insights of what really makes an algorithm something of a black box. What is the criteria we look at?
Yeah, I guess algorithms in simplified terms are recipes full of decision trees. So do you want a healthy meal go left? Do you want a pizza go right? And until there, it's very understandable. But the problem we're facing with algorithms is that they're becoming more and more complex. Apart from the complexity, we often don't know what an algorithm does and what data is being used because companies won't tell us. We don't know what information we share on social media or in our internet behavior is being used by these platforms to analyze us. So several big tech companies like Google and Facebook started to publish all political advertisement to be transparent. But obviously, they are exactly as transparent as they want to be. What these political advertisement libraries don't show us is who they target with several advertisements and how this influences them. So these platforms are very selective in the information they share with us.
So maybe it's a good exercise for us to just imagine, right? So we really thrive to build a utopian scenario that ensures citizens are guaranteed their privacy and autonomy. Just in the middle of all these dark patterns, in these complex, ever-evolving algorithms. So how would this utopian scenario look like for you as a humanitarian policy advisor?
So in the last years, we found out a lot about risks of algorithms and AI use. We know it is able to increase inequality and that using historic data results in repeating history. And this information is incredibly important to start using technology in a safe and fair way in which we decrease these risks and protect human rights. But what if AI and algorithms could actually improve equality and justice? What if we actually start learning from historical data and use this data not to repeat history, but improve the future? There are so many stories behind the data we use, stories about our society and the problems that we face in it. Data about the employment and salaries of women tell a story about labor discrimination against women. Data about representation of migrants in crime rates tell a story about ethnic profiling. Data about the level of education of children tell a story about teachers systematically under-advising children from lower income classes and different backgrounds. So looking at these data as being neutral and objective doesn't make any sense. There's nothing neutral about these situations, and translating them into numbers and statistics doesn't change that. we need to redefine how we interpret data and how we can learn from them to actually improve society.
I really think that kind of using the bias in the data that we collect as an indicator of historical biases in society and kind of taking an offensive mode into counteracting these biases, even outside of AI, is such a crucial, critical, and revolutionary idea. Do you kind of have any steps or any kind of protocols going forward and how we can do that, how we can achieve that utopian scenario that you just explained?
Yeah, I think we should start by including the origin of data into the legal process. The GDPR only provides rules on data use when personal data is being used and anonymized data is beyond the scope of the GDPR. And the law proposal of the European Commission on AI, the Artificial Intelligence Act, isn't providing an answer for this gap either. And this is very problematic because the data that is being used is an important source and it is the starting point of algorithm in AI use. So the data we use really matters and we need to be far more aware about how we're collecting data, purpose, and the legality of it. When it comes to algorithms and AI, things often seem very complicated, but that's not always the case. We at Bits of Freedom find it really important to inform people about what is going on and how people can protect their rights. We have an international tool called My Data Done Right, which can be used to appeal on GDPR rights, like the rights of access, rectification, and deletion. And it's really necessary that people hold data controllers accountable.
Awesome. So I think these are quite tangible steps in kind of the mode of awareness that we can partake to ensure this utopian scenario where there's like equitable transfer of information when we're targeting more marginalized parts of society. All right, so we should really have a collective approach into raising sirens and alarms, exposing the algorithmic harms, and lobbying for laws to change and building these systems of accountability.
You triggered me with the wording, these systems of accountability, right? Because here we're talking about legal systems and social systems. An interesting challenge would be, can we also have technological systems of accountability, so to speak? In essence, laws are also a bit like algorithms. And one way of looking at the current status of laws and technology is that laws are a very, almost like a primitive relic carried over by generations. And now we have technology. So if we design systems again, maybe the technology will be much more sort of interwoven into the way we also do law.
Yeah, I would say so. And I'm glad you're mentioning this because I compare law to AI and algorithms as well very often. And I think one of the most important differences is that we, by creating laws, we look at society, we're using historic data, and we're trying to make rules to find a way how we're going to live together in this society. And then these laws are very severe in a way. But then we have a lot of legal cases in which judges are trying some way to work out these laws in reality. Judges are taking circumstances as a very important part of their jurisdiction. And I think that is a very important difference with technology, especially with algorithms, because algorithms work with historical data, but it's very different to include certain circumstances into the technology. And what we see in law is that laws change quite often based on all these different cases in which the law works or doesn't work at all. We learn from them. And I wonder how we're going to improve technology, including these circumstances as well. I think that's a really interesting and important challenge we're facing.
So you could say that law is a predecessor of machine learning in the sense that it's slow, but it also learns over time. And also that in order to learn, you need humans to actually change the laws in this case. And the second is that there's always a human involved when it comes to the decision making. I don't think there's a legal system in the world, as far as I'm not an expert, but I don't think there's a system in the world where the law book itself makes the verdict. There's always a human, like you say, take the conflict into example. So perhaps We as technologists can also learn from these centuries of legal systems growing over time and changing over time, but also always having these two constants. When it comes to decision making, there needs to be a human in the loop and an interpretation of the law. And when it comes to changing the laws, there needs to be also humans in the loop, because how else are you going to get the ideals into the system, which I think reflects back on what we just discussed previously.
Yeah, true. And I think when writing a law, we include a lot of, I guess, subjective factors into the steps before making a decision. We look at the circumstances that lead a person into committing a crime, for example. And these subjective factors are sometimes very important before making a decision. And that is something that is quite difficult to translate into technology.
I really often think about Lawrence Lessig's book. So he had the book called Code 2.0, and he effectively talks about how often, especially in the earlier days of the internet, code itself was law. That de facto, when you wrote a piece of code, it just becomes the law of the space until a regulatory body, until the AI Commission in the European Union writes something new. So it always seems to me like a cat and dog chase, but I'm always missing, like Stefan said, the human in the loop approach. So when you're rethinking the law, or you're thinking the governing principles, that there's a human. But even further, I like to interrogate this notion of saying that there needs to be a community in the loop, because it's not one person or one body telling society what their principles are. It's society constantly negotiating with itself. And if we look at the latest AI legislation from Europe, because there's one that recently came out of like AI principles for the European Union. What do you feel it's missing? What do you feel it does well, and what do you feel it's missing?
I think there's a lot missing, to be honest. I'm really glad it's here. And I think the attention to call on something subjective is great, but I think there's still room for some improvement. And when it comes to the human in the loop, because the law proposal speaks on that as well, I think we really have to think about how this law is going to work out in practice. People are biased as well. So I really like your idea about there should be a community in the loop. And also, I think if we say that an algorithm is going to do part of the job, and then we have a human in the loop who is taking the actual decision, we need to think really good about what we expect from humans and how much we're going to weigh on the decisions of algorithms.
We're slowly together building the image of that kind of utopian society, which we talked about earlier, that it's a system not with one safeguard, so the law is maybe one safeguard, but multiple safeguards against algorithmic harm and violence. That you have, at one instance, the code itself is measured against bias. You have a law that safeguards it against bias. You have a human in the loop that tries. If all these things fail, you have a community to hold these systems accountable, and you have civil society to raise awareness and to raise alarm. So it's kind of a system that works together in tangents.
So here's a nice challenge. Let's see if we can map this onto the panopticon in some way. So the panopticon, the idea is, and I think many of the aspects of the panopticon have already been mentioned. So person being watched, person or algorithm being sort of the watcher, and the lack of information, I think both about whether or not you are being watched, as with the cameras, but also perhaps the lack of information on how this information is being used as a decision-making tool. So here the black box has a functional purpose. Because it's a black box, it creates an insecurity, and this insecurity creates a motive for, let's say, conforming to a law or to an ethical principle. And so we know how this system works, or this mechanism works, when it comes to, let's say, a large organization or a government in relation to individuals. But can we also map this on the situation we just described, with the community actually enforcing social laws or ethical laws? I mean, those are not like legal laws, of course. Enforcing these laws, perhaps not on an individual, but on an organization.
Could you give an example of a social or ethical law that you're thinking of?
Well, why not start with, say, racial injustice, for example? There are legal laws, but perhaps those legal laws are not enough. or according to a social community, we feel they're inadequate or inadequately enforced. So what mechanism can we design to actually enforce those social laws beyond the legal laws?
Yeah, I think we, like I've mentioned before, we need to think about the data that we're using, the historical data. There are a lot of practices that are unethical and full of bias, but are still legal, as you mentioned. For example, ethnic profiling by the police. It is very difficult to prove that these practices of the police are illegal, because it's very difficult to control the police and to find out their intentions and the policies they're using. So we need to talk about the reason why police officers are ethnic profiling. And we need to talk about our history, for example, our Dutch or European history that is full of racism and full of bias that lead to certain decisions being made by police officers or by the police as a larger entity. And that is something we can solve with legislation. That is a talk we need to have in our society. And we need to understand our behavior, because our behavior influences the data we're using for example, algorithms or AI.
And so trying to take this one step further, what data could we collect, for example, in order to promote this discussion? Because the solution won't be technological. It probably won't be legal either, but it won't be technological. You know, we won't come up with a technology that solves our problems.
Yeah.
But maybe a technology can be designed that provides us with the tools or the data that actually helps the discussion move forward.
So which data is missing in that case to help the conversation move forward?
I think data that is showing these problems we face in society. So for example, when it comes to ethnic profiling, a couple of civil societies have been collecting data on ethnic profiling, like Control-Alt-Delete, Amnesty, Radar. These are a couple of organizations which have collected data from people who have been subject to ethnic profiling. People have shared their stories on what happened. And by collecting several cases of ethnic profiling, they were able to talk to the police about this problem and confront them about it and show them that we're not talking about individual cases or incidents, but this is a structural problem. But if they weren't able to collect these data, it would be the words of individuals against the word of the police. So it's incredibly important to have this knowledge, to be able to prove it, and then to be able to start a conversation.
Taking it back to the Panopticon example, there's two sides of forcing a law. The first is the sampling, which is actually the actual collection of data. The second is the threat of collecting data. So it's the person or organization being subjected to the surveillance who feels that at some point data might be collected. And so that leads to a almost like a proactive change in behavior. So if we map this back onto our example that we have, it would mean that, let's say, the police in this case, knowing that data is collected by NGOs, for example, without actually knowing which data is collected or when or why, would actually change its behavior because there might be a threat of data being collected.
Okay, so this was actually the reason to develop the app that police officers were supposed to use with every police control, to have data about ethnic profiling, but also to discourage ethnic profiling by the police. And then the result was that police officers weren't using the app. So when it comes to influencing behavior, it would either be, or at least that was the original idea, that they would be aware of their biases and think about it before they act, before they have a police control. But the behavior that resulted was that they were just not using the app.
I think it's actually a good conversation about the gadgets we can use. Of course, we can't predict the cultures of use that are going to happen. We can't predict that the system is going to work. But I really like that, okay, there is some sort of inequality in knowing and power, and you introduce a gadget to equal the playing field, right? And I know Bits of Freedom has done a few of those. So this was one example. What are maybe other tools that, I don't know, people can check out, look at, that are aimed at equaling the playing field?
Yeah, so always look at our websites. We write a lot about what is going on in our digital society. We have a lot of different dossiers that we talk about, including AI and algorithms. But if you actually want to do something and increase your own awareness, definitely go check out the kortecursusmanipulatie.nl, which is this online course about online manipulation by platforms. And also mydatadoneright.eu, which can be used to appeal on GDPR rights. Use it to question controllers about how your data is being used. You can send it to any organization that has data on you.
I think this is quite nice because from the conversation that we are having, from the conversation that Stefan was kind of initiating, there is maybe multiple points of oversight. There's kind of oversight by design, the panopticon effect. There is a civil society point of oversight. There's oversight using inquiry, that you're proactively going and asking people, invoking your right to know. And then there's oversight by law and legal codes. And I think somehow if we can combine those in a coherent, seamless system, maybe we get much closer into building this utopian society we all aspire. At this point, I don't have any more questions, but I also want to ask you if Stefan or Nadia have any concluding remarks, because this is also the last episode of our inquiry. You are the last guest. If you have any closing remarks, hopes, for example, an appeal to make, this could be a space for it.
Yeah, I really like your conclusion. We're in this together, so we all have a role to play.
No, I think that's very poetic, because in a surveillance society, there should be no passive actors. No one can be passive. All of us have to be proactive. And I think it is a beautiful kind of note to end on. I personally see the poetry in it, but also the criticality of that call. Stefan, maybe you can make an appeal.
Well, so from this conversation, but also from previous conversations, one takeaway for me is that surveillance can be counteracted with other kinds of surveillance, or we can just stop the surveying altogether. And I don't think anybody has the answer to which approach is best. So where do we go from there? Well, I think one thing that we should do, and I think these conversations should help us do it as well, is experiment. As long as we're honest about where we want to go and honest to ourselves on how far we're getting with it.
Yeah, I completely echo that sentiment. And I think in parallel with experimenting, or even preceding the experimentation, I think we should take the freedom to speculate, which we have been doing in these conversations, and to really speculate radically about alternate futures, futures that are plausible and preferable. And I think we've done that beautifully in these conversations. So I actually would like to really thank you a lot, Nadia, for your generosity, your insight.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, and thank you, Stefan, for joining us again and for enriching the conversation as well.
Thank you, Abdul. Thank you for hosting.
You're welcome. This has been a pleasure.
For more information, links and show notes, please visit futurebased.org.